The 1970s was a significant decade for Christmas songs. There's the glam rock monoliths, the novelty songs, disco songs, songs by singer-songwriters and prog rock artists, and even two songs from former Beatles of drastically varying quality. But one 70s associated genre that didn't make many Christmas songs is punk. But while young scamps, the Sex Pistols and Clash were raging about having no future and a nuclear war, the first notable punk rock Christmas song was written by a band over a decade into their career. This is New Christmas Canon, and this is the story of the Kinks, Father Christmas. The Kinks had been many things in their first decade. They were the progenitors of punk and metal, with their breakthrough third single, You Really Got Me. They were the British invasion band that got barred from the US for 4 years due to visa issues. They were the oh-so-English social commentators of a well-respected man. Doing the best thing, so conservatively. Dedicated follower of fashion. Eagerly pursuing all the latest fancy trends. Sunny afternoon. The taxman's taken all my dough. And Waterloo sunset. They were the creators of self-aware nostalgic odes to traditional English ways on the Village Green Preservation Society. God save strawberry jam and all the different varieties. And an essential influence on detail-focused British artists Ian Dury, The Jam, Madness, XTC, Blur, and Lily Allen. And they were also the band with an unlikely crossover smash about a country boy becoming besotted with a crossdresser. Girls will be boys and boys will be girls. It's a mixed up mumbled up sugar world. Since the beginning, the Kinks had remained gloriously out of step with musical trends. While their contemporaries experimented with psychedelia and rock operas, they were producing 3-minute kitchen sink dramas. And so it continued. 1971's Muswell Hillbillies was a caustic yet witty country rock criticism of the so-called advances of society. While the rest of their contemporaries were making monolithic statements of era-defining rock, with Sticky Fingers, Who's Next, and Led Zeppelin 4. Muswell Hillbillies was a hit with critics, but unlike their peers' efforts, evaded significant record sales, not even charting in the UK. Instead of acknowledging the listening public's collective shrugs, frontman Ray Davies doubled down. Mid-70s Kinks were consumed by grand, politically charged rock operas, packed with far-reaching casts of characters, steeped in English musical tradition. Writing songs for old time vaudeville reviews. All my friends would ask me what it's all leading to. The most significant of these was the Preservation double LP, Act 1, released in November 1973. Act 2 following 6 months later. This aligned with a refocus on the US market, playing the Preservation albums in their entirety across the states, with the four-piece lineup augmented by grandiose production, various costumed sidemen and backup singers. Not only was this a heavy money sink, Ray's brother Dave, formerly an equal songwriter within the band, had concerns as to their direction and how he was being treated, Ray especially belittling Dave's solo achievements. We were moving too far in the direction of the Kinks existing only as Ray Davies' backing band. Was Ray's megalomania feeding his narcissism, or the other way around? He teased me on stage, calling me his annoying little brother, or here's Dave, death of a clown Davis, anything to patronize me and keep me in my place. As AV Club would later state of Act 2, with its radio announcements and melodramatic sub-Andrew Lloyd Webber musical numbers, it's a wash, the sound of a once great band losing the plot. In the age of Ziggy Stardust, it wasn't enough to write a good story and put it to music. As fantastic a story snippet as Starman might be, its strength comes from the fact that it stands alone, and it doesn't need the rest of the album to make sense, something that the Kinks had seemingly forgotten with their concept albums. 1976's Schoolboys in Disgrace, another concept piece, albeit a more rocking one. Would be their last album with their label RCA. Moving on with Arista, Ray realized he needed to change tact. I made a conscious effort to sit down and say, I'm going to make 12 good songs here that we can tour with, and no funny outfits and no character changes, and just be the band. And I think the band were relieved, because I know it was pissing Dave off. So we went back with Sleepwalker and started serious rebuilding. Released in February 1977, Sleepwalker was seen as a return to form for the Kinks, at least in the US, removing the excesses of their last 5 years, back to creating some solid rock and roll songs. I'm a sleepwalker. While they had maintained their appeal as a touring act, their record sales had plateaued, and they hadn't had an album grasped within the top 40 of the Billboard 200 since 1971's Lola vs. Power Man. Sleepwalker reached a lofty number 21, and thanks to new label Arista, got the band mainstream exposure on The Mike Douglas Show and Saturday Night Live. The moment was theirs to lose. Returning to their studio Conk in July of 1977, they started to record follow-up Misfits. But as the year wore on, and with bassist Andy Pyle and keyboardist John Goslin both handing in their resignation before its completion, it seemed less and less likely that the band would be able to complete their full length before 1978 rolled around. But wanting to continue the band's rare upwards momentum, Arista suggested the band release a Christmas single to tie in with their November-December tours. For this, they would take inspiration from what was happening in Britain at the time. In November 1976, the Sex Pistols unleashed anarchy in the UK onto an unsuspecting public. Anarchy for the UK, it's coming sometime. Taking the kind of primal, distorted guitar chords that the Kinks had popularized with You Really Got Me, and revving them up to pogo speed. Combined with the spit and sneer of Johnny Rotten, it was the moment the general public were made aware of punk rock. Ray Davis was ahead of the pack, already wise to what was going on in the punk underground in New York. Having met Patti Smith way back in 1971, he even told The Guardian that this new wave of UK punk was a bit of a joke, saying that he admired true punk, like the Ramones or Lou Reed, but not the bands jumping onto it the way bands got onto the R&B kick when we first started. However, Dave immediately saw these punk groups as their offspring. I couldn't help feeling a kinship in the music. I always felt these bands and the Kinks to be on a similar wavelength. Their in-your-face attitude was belligerent and unforgiving. Punk followed up on themes questioning society that bands like the Kinks had posed. The lineage was clear. But the feeling wasn't exactly mutual. The then-present-day version of the Kinks was considered a joke. The disappointment of the previous 5 years' overblown concept albums wasn't going to disperse right away. Although many punk musicians got their start bashing out the elemental chords of All Day and All of the Night, they would have preferred that the Kinks never made it out of the 60s. The Davises would need to actively dislodge their past it status. A lot of the British punks were energized by the state of things of the time, like mass unemployment, strikes, riots, and ineffective government. Likewise, as Ray had done in the 60s, he looked out the window and saw an opportunity for a 3-minute standalone statement of intent. Revising their sound with the aggression of punk, the Kinks wrote a Christmas song for the ages. Father Christmas was completed in October 1977. and from the start, it marked itself apart from other Christmas songs. While Greg Lake says he believes in Father Christmas. I look to the sky with excited eyes. From its first line, Ray's protagonist knows that to be a lie. When I was small, I believed in Santa Claus, though I knew it was my dad. Pulling down the magical facade that pervades the subgenre. In the song, Ray plays the role of a department store Santa who gets ambushed by a bunch of children. And as the song's chant-along chorus makes clear, theirs is not a desire for Steve Austin action figures and cuddly toys. They're sticking up this pseudo-Santa for hard currency. The kids weren't alright, and they knew that trivial playthings weren't going to improve their situation. We don't want a jinx or a monopoly money, we only want the real McCoy. Like how Sunny Afternoon criticised the introduction of progressive tax rates, Father Christmas commented on the joblessness that was rife in Britain at the time, more families than ever being below the breadline. But give my daddy a job cause he needs work, he's got lots of mouths to feed. With the circumstances getting so bad the following year, widespread strikes exacerbated by the coldest winter in a generation, November 1978 to February 1979 would be known as the Winter of Discontent. Have yourself a merry, merry Christmas, have yourself a good time. As such, the commercial, idealized vision of Christmas, pushed by festive media, was a sick joke to those in need. But remember the kids who got nothing. While you're drinking down your wine. Father Christmas hoodwinks listeners with its opening, utilizing the well-worn Christmas song instrumental tropes of glockenspiel and sleigh bells, disguising its sour take on the subgenre. The twinkle of its opening bars recalls the working-class romance of Bruce Springsteen's Thunder Road. But unlike the boss, Davis's characters aren't escaping this state of affairs. Its introductory chimes are contrasted with Dave's guitar work. The whole time it has this acidic, punkish hue. Aggressive, distorted palm mutes. And I would hang up my stocking at Christmas, open my presents and joined by screaming, napalm-powered peals, like those of the Stooges' Search and Destroy. Father Christmas is very special to me, because it was an opportunity to put interesting guitar parts in there. Guitar riffs that I think sound great. Unlike a lot of punk, Ray sugared the message with humour, though the aggression and bitterness remained. Dave said it reflected their experiences growing up working class in Muswell Hill. I could see the faces of my parents when Christmas came around. They had to struggle to make ends meet. We kind of got what we needed, but there was something fake about the holiday. But the real question was the world ready for a Christmas song about Father Christmas getting assaulted and robbed by some disenfranchised children? Father Christmas was released in late November 1977, but promoting the single was marred somewhat by the strained relationship between the brothers. According to Kinks keyboard player John Goslin, the pair came to blows while filming the track's music video.
We were supposed to attack Father Christmas, Ray, and steal his bag of toys. And Dave got a bit further into the action than he should have done, and we had to pull Dave away from Ray, who was on the floor by now with his Father Christmas beard around to the side, and Dave was attacking him like, no, Dave.
From the previous half decade of being a less than essential member of the group, Dave was still holding on to a lot of resentment for Ray, but at the same time, being brothers in a band together, they were prone to fucking with each other. While on their last tour of 1977, Father Christmas would be placed as the first song of their encore, so Ray could go off stage and change into a Santa getup. On one occasion, Dave would use this opportunity to prank his brother. As he returned to the stage as Saint Nick, Dave launched into "You Really Got Me" instead. The sheer look of horror on Ray's face. As the crowd roared and the penny dropped, they was gonna have to sing "You Really Got Me" dressed like a prat. This was all my Christmases come at once. Every so often, he glared at me through his plastic white beard, and I cheerfully smiled back. He was trapped. Afterwards, he tore off his costume and chucked it at me. The vision of Santa charging around the room and screaming, "You're a fucking cunt," is imprinted on my memory. While in the US, the band did some support shows for Daryl Hall and John Oates, who'd recently hit the big leagues with Sarah Smile. And Rich Girl. And the Kinks' desire to do an encore as a support act didn't sit well with the headliner. I went on dressed as Santa at the end of the show to do Father Christmas, and the other band found it hard to follow us. The following night with the same band, I went to run on, but there was a bunch of heavies preventing me from running on stage. And I was protesting, but the people said the Kinks didn't do an encore, but Santa Claus was there, and they were stopping him from going on stage. Father Christmas failed to chart in both the UK and the US. This was not helped by BBC and Capital Radio being hesitant to play the track, partly as an anti-Christmas song didn't seem in the spirit of the season, partly due to their unofficial ban on playing punk music. The public instead opted for escapism, and the Christmas number one that year was taken by Paul McCartney's Mull of Kintyre. However, Father Christmas can lay claim to being one of the first punk rock Christmas songs. The same year as The Ravers, it's gonna be a punk rock Christmas.
It's gonna be a punk rock Christmas this year.
3 years before The Damned, There Ain't No Sanity Clause. And The Yobb's Christmas album. And 12 years before the Ramones' Merry Christmas, I Don't Wanna Fight Tonight.
Merry Christmas, I don't wanna fight tonight. Merry Christmas, I don't want to fight tonight.
It's also since become a staple by punk, hair metal and power pop bands that want to cover a Christmas song with a bit of an edge. Dave is especially impressed by the far-reaching interpretations of the song, though admits there is one version he would have loved to have heard. Always thought the Ramones would do a great version of it. I don't know why they didn't do it. Despite not charting on release, Father Christmas marked the start of Ray and Dave back in a more collaborative mode. An important step on the way to the 80s Kinks renaissance. Singles, Better Things. Come Dancing.
Come Dancing. All our boyfriends used to come and call.
Being their first UK charting singles in almost a decade. All they needed was a bit of family time, some infighting, and a brief detour into political discourse. Father Christmas may stand as an ultimate anti-Christmas anthem, but its creation couldn't be more in the spirit of the season. Thanks for watching. What's your favourite out there Christmas song? Comment down below, and if you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favour and share it with a couple of people. It really does help. Also, I'd like to shout out all my supporters over on Patreon. Thank you so very much, and I'll see you next year for whatever's next.